Join me, please, in the call to worship that is printed in your bulletin. We will give thanks to you, O Lord, with all our hearts. Before all others, we will sing your praise. Because of your love and faithfulness, we will bow down and praise your name. Bless the Lord.
The Lord's
name be praised.
But in our worst moments, God does not leave us. God does not abandon our needs. It is with this unconditional love in mind that we go to God confessing our shortcomings. Let us pray the prayer of confession together. O Lord, our God, look upon us with your mercy, for we have strayed from your ways and ignored your commands. Forgive us when we have thought too highly of ourselves and forgotten to trust not in our own strength, but in the strength of your love for us. Guide us as we seek to follow Jesus with all humility, and give us the grace we need to live in a way that reflects your generosity towards us. Through Jesus our Lord. Declares the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abiding in steadfast love. And the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Believe this good news, friends. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Friends in Christ, in response to this gift of God's grace, then how shall we live? With gratitude, following after the Lord Jesus Christ, who calls us to love God with heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbors as ourselves. This is the way of Jesus, in whom we find life.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God for the worship and music. Some joys and concerns to share with you this morning. Laura Johnson has had a stay in the hospital fighting pneumonia, so we ask for prayers for Laura Johnson. I made a bit of a mistake this morning. Edith Robertson has actually suffered a neck injury that we just learned about last week, and I believe this is the second neck injury that she has suffered in the past few years, so please keep the Robertson family in your prayers as she seeks recovery in that. Betty Crisp had a successful surgery, so that is a prayer of thanks to offer up. And in particular, we want to offer up prayers of thanksgiving and prayers of fortitude for all of those returning to school and to work, teachers, administrators, students who are headed back to doing something new starting tomorrow. C.S. Lewis has a famous quote that says, "True humility is not thinking less of yourself, it is thinking of yourself less." So putting aside all of our worries, our concerns, the lists we have, putting aside our very tendencies to be concerned with ourselves, let us pray, fully present to a God who loves us just as we are. Let us pray together. God of grace and of glory, we often approach you as if we don't need you, but simply want to know you are there. We go about our daily lives from morning to night, throwing a glance at your love from time to time, but often not stopping to sense your presence in others, to sense your presence in ourselves. We look to you in times of great need, but often forget to keep you in our daily conversations, in our moments of thanksgiving and of triumph, thinking that we have done it on our own and that we can do it on our own. We move through life forgetting that you are the cornerstone on which all of our foundations are to be set. Forgive us our lack of awareness, O God, of your constant presence and your gentle nudges. You offer us eyes to see and ears to hear your good news in all things, in every person we meet, in every moment we breathe. Help us to clear our vision of ourselves so that our sight is more squarely focused on you, and our work to bring your kingdom to earth is daily practiced through love and reconciliation. We ask you to be with those in this city who will have no cool shelter today as our temperatures soar. We ask for your presence to be known to those in this nation who are battling floodwaters and wildfires. We ask for your hand to be at work in this world, wherever children are scared, wherever families are torn, wherever war is a way of life. We ask a special blessing this day on all those for whom this week is a new beginning, for students and for teachers, for administrators and for workers. Guide them with your loving hands to do the great work you offer us and to share their love with all they meet. God, help us see how our hands, our feet, our mouths, and our hearts are instruments of your peace. And guide us to do your will to heal a broken world and to offer your grace and love to all those we meet. And as we raise up our many voices in prayer, we pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Thank you.
like to invite all of the children to come down and join me for a moment together. Good morning. Don't be shy. There is room for all down here. Thank you, friend. You may want to bet for me, okay? All right. We've got a few more. Come on down. How are you today? Good? Everybody good? Tomorrow might be the start of something new for you. What might tomorrow be that if you haven't already started it, you're going to start it tomorrow? School. My daughter is already in school. If you're in year-round school, you've been in for weeks now, haven't you? But you know what? Every time we start something new, there's always that possibility that it's going to be scary, right?
Yep.
Starting something new is always... it's unknown, it's different. Sometimes we can get scared of it. And you know how sometimes people respond to scary things? What do you think, Peter?
It's actually not very scary for me.
Good.
Because I had the same teacher 2 years ago.
That always helps. It always helps to know who your teacher is going in ahead of time, right? That makes it a little less scary. Well, sometimes...
yeah, like I was so scared before meet the teacher I had on Thursday, but then
yep.
Guess what?
What's
once
that?
I found out that my teacher was really nice, I was like, you know what? This is going to be fine.
And that is a perfect example of what I was just about to talk about. One of the ways, having your teacher, meeting your teacher, and finding out that your teacher is a really nice person is a really easy way to let go of some of that fear of the new, right? Well, what I want you to remember, when you're starting school tomorrow or you're going back to school for a new week, our job as Christians is to enter into every new thing with love. Not with fear, because sometimes when you have fear about something, it makes you think, well, I'm not going to be any good at this, so I might as well just be mean, or I might as well just give up, or I might as well just sit back and do nothing. And that doesn't actually help make a situation better, does it? One of the things that we are going to talk about a little bit today that Miss Anna is going to talk about in her sermon is making sure that we are paying attention as Christians to the way we present ourselves to others. We are not going in to a new school year thinking we are the best and we are going to do all of the best things and have all of the best days, because that may not actually happen, right? Our job is to remember that God loves us exactly as we are right this minute. You don't have to do a single thing to change. God loves you exactly as you are. And because of that love, you walk out into a new school day, a new school year, and you say, I'm gonna give away some of that love every day. If God loves me exactly as I am, that means I have more than enough love to give away every day. And that's what I want to challenge you to do, friends, as we start this new school year. I want you to practice feeling that love, knowing that you are exactly the way God made you, and it's just right, and giving some of that love away every single day. And what I have for you that Jack M. is going to give to each friend up here this morning is a survival kit. You have to have a survival kit when you go out into the wilderness, and sometimes a new school and a new day feels like a wilderness. So I have a little survival kit for you to help you feel the love of God and give the love of God away. So while Jack gives everybody one of these bags, I'm going to read to you what's in it. Your survival kit has post-it notes to remind you to list your blessings every day. It has a Band-Aid to help heal hurt feelings along the way. It has a stick of gum to remind you to stick with it, because God can help you accomplish many things. A stick of gum, a stick of chewing gum, bubble gum. It has a glow stick to help you remember to share your light with the world. And finally, it has a Tootsie Roll to remind you that God is always with you, even when you bite off more than you can chew. So you're going to take this survival kit with you, and you're going to eat the candy and chew the gum and play with the post-it notes, but you're going to keep this sheet with you to remember that God loves you just the way you are. And your job in all of these new days is to go out and share that love with others. All right? So Jack, let's make sure everybody gets one. I'll hand this one to Davis. Go ahead and hand one out to everybody, okay? And as Jack is handing them out, we're going to all pray together, all right? God of love, thank you for giving us new days. Thank you for giving us new years. Thank you for giving us each other. We know you made us just as you would have us to be. Help us go out and show our love to others always. In your gracious name we pray. Amen. Thank you, friends. Go out and have a wonderful day. Make sure you get yourself one.
Pray with me, please. Gracious God, we thank you first for our risen Savior. We thank you for all the wonderful opportunities and services that we have as Christians in love and in service. Let us always answer when we are called. With open hearts, we listen to your scripture this morning, and may it always be our guide and our hope for our future. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture this morning is from the 2 Corinthians, 5th chapter, verses 14 through 18. This section is titled, The Ministry of Reconciliation. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. We see everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second scripture lesson comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14, verses 1 and then 7 through 14. Listen with me now for the word of the Lord. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the place of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, "Give this person your place." And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place so that when your host comes, he may say to you, "Friend, move up higher." Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors in case they might invite you in return, and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. And you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." Here ends our reading. This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And again, let us pray. Lord, we humble ourselves and lay our lives open before this, your word. And we ask that your spirit would stir in us as we consider where it might send us and how you might shape us through it. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. If you've been in worship with us over the summer, then you know that for the most part, we have been spending a lot of time together in the Gospel of Luke. And for the past several weeks, we have been in that section in Luke where Jesus is journeying on to Jerusalem, and he is encouraging his followers to free themselves from the attachments of this world so that they might truly be citizens of a new kingdom, the kingdom of God. We have heard for several weeks sermons based on Jesus' teachings about eschewing selfishness and becoming rich by becoming generous. We've been reminded to trust in God's providence for our lives as opposed to our own anxious strivings. And we've heard stories of Jesus tending to the least of these and healing the sick by touching those who are lowly or outcast or unclean. And all of these stories, I think, echo a familiar theme in the Gospels, and particularly in Luke, which is that the first shall be last and the last shall be first. It's called a gospel reversal. And that simply means that the good news of Jesus Christ turns the logic of this world on its head. It means that Jesus ushers in a whole new order of things, where the lowly are honored and the haughty are put to shame. Gospel reversal. In our story for today, at least initially, Jesus is riffing on what is perhaps his most famous theme. Jesus is in the home of a Pharisee with a group of Pharisees, who in that day were leaders in the temple and experts in religious law. People often deferred to their interpretation of God's law, and they had become accustomed to such deference. And even though the text tells us that they were all watching Jesus carefully to see what he would do at the meal, it is Jesus who turns out to be all the more perceptive. For Jesus notices in these religious elite the all too human behavior of jockeying for position and prestige around that table. They were all trying to sit in the important seats, which is why he reiterates his famous theme for them and for us. When you're invited to a dinner party, he says, don't take up the place of honor, but instead go and sit at the lowest place. It's a different way of saying the first shall be last and the last shall be first, that backbone conviction of the Gospel of Luke, which begins as early as chapter 1 with Mary herself, when she learns that she has been chosen to bear Jesus, the Messiah, into the world, and she lifts up her voice to belt out the Magnificat. You remember the words she sings, don't you? My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in my Savior, she sings. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. He has brought the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. The mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Gospel reversal. It's a theme in Luke, and one that we are at least accustomed to hearing from Jesus, even as it remains difficult to live by. But then, around that Pharisee's table, Jesus plays a little variation on the theme. Like a skilled jazz musician, he adds to it, deepening its character. And it's that little innovation that has captured my imagination this week as I've revisited this story. Jesus actually delivers two disruptive words in this scene, if you are listening closely. And the second one is addressed not to the guests, but to the host. He says to him, when you have a dinner party, don't invite your neighbors or your family or prestigious colleagues or anyone else who can repay you for your generosity. But instead, when you host a banquet, go out and invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, because they cannot repay you. Surely we can hear loud and clear the echoes of that original theme replayed here. But Jesus takes it one step further, talking not just about our behavior or our habits, but about the importance of the expectations we bring into our relationships, and how those expectations so often determine the kinds of relationships we're willing to invest in. And that's a convicting word, because here Jesus asks us to take stock of our own motivations when it comes to the relationships we choose, even our own motivations behind how and to whom we show generosity. Are we giving only so that we can receive? Are there strings attached to the gifts we give to others so that we might have some power over them? Are we only interested in relationships that promise to benefit us materially or boost our reputations or our egos? Or in our relationships with God's other children, are we truly, freely offering ourselves, our time, our love, all of the gifts that God has given to us? Do we offer these things expecting nothing in return? Because we have recognized that that's how God gives gifts, freely, with love, and without expectation of repayment. When I was fresh out of college and beginning my first job, which was at a large bank, I was encouraged by my manager to attend a professional development seminar. And so dutifully, I registered and I walked the few blocks to the conference hall where it was to be held, and I got my name tag and I took a seat. And the topic for the day was effective networking. The charismatic speaker commanded our attention with ease. And so I spent the day scribbling notes, and I exchanged cards with others as a part of this kind of awkward practice exercise in networking. And I left that afternoon with a souvenir book in my hand called Never Eat Alone. You don't have to read the book to anticipate its punchline. If you want to get ahead in this world, then never eat alone. Having lunch by yourself is but a wasted opportunity for advancement. The book encourages its reader to turn every single midday meal into an opportunity to connect and get your name out there with the right people, to forge relationships with those who've got influence, so that one day, someday, when an opportunity comes along, your name will be at the top of the stack. And all of those times you graciously invited people to break bread with you will pay off for you. Our culture is shot through with the expectation of reciprocity, a kind of I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine ethic of payback. It is so automatic for us that it is often jarring when someone acts outside the mold, which is what happened to me just the other morning when I was in the drive-thru line at the Caribou Coffee over by Rex Hospital. It had been a really, really hectic morning. And our daughter, Margaret, was in the back seat chattering and screeching and trying to command my attention, which at 16 months old, she knows how to do quite well. And I confess that I was distracted. So I was looking in my rearview mirror, trying to get her to be just a little bit quieter. And before I knew it, I had lightly tapped the car in front of me, somehow lifting my foot slightly off the brake. So horrified, I jumped out of the car and knocked on the driver's window, not sure who I would be encountering, and she jumped out of her car, and together we looked at the bumpers and determined that there had thankfully been no damage to either. So I apologized profusely again before getting back in the car, and she was gracious and kind to me before getting back in hers, and I was thankful for that. And having learned my lesson, I maintained a little bigger distance between us as we waited. Well, after she had picked up her order and driven away, I pulled my car forward to the service window to pay for my coffee. But as I was reaching for my wallet, the employee at the window told me to put it away because the girl in front of me had paid for my order. And then she had told her to tell me not to worry. Humbling. Of course, I had no way of thanking her for her kindness, which really was a witness to grace to me that day because she had already driven away and I didn't even know her name. And it's such a small thing she did for me, I know. But I have thought about it every day since it happened, how I had been in the wrong, how other than offering apology, it actually hadn't even occurred to me to do anything to make it right, and how she had shown me such free generosity without expecting anything in return. And how I have no way to repay her except to live more generously in my own relationships. Such a simple encounter set me to wondering whether I ever act with such pure grace, expecting little return, and what the world would look like were it to be filled with people who every day, even in small ways, did their best to give to others without immediately thinking of the tax credit they would receive or recognition they would enjoy. Probably not that often that Larry David is mentioned in a sermon, I admit it. But there's an episode of his HBO sitcom, Curb Your Enthusiasm, in which Larry donates a large sum of money for a wing at an art gallery. And he arrives to the opening of this art gallery to discover that across from the Larry David wing is a wing given by Anonymous. Except everyone knows who Anonymous is because Anonymous has taken it upon himself to whisper that he's the donor to a few people who have whispered it to a few more people who are going on and on about how generous and humble he is for giving such a large sum of money but not wanting to take the credit by having his name on the wall. Of course, he did want the credit, and he made sure that he got it, albeit in a roundabout way. Here's what you should know about table scenes in the Gospel of Luke. When you hear that Jesus is sharing a meal with someone, you should think to yourself, Kingdom of God. Think of it as a surefire textual clue, because in the Gospel of Luke, every time Jesus sits down at a table, every time there's a scene in which eating is taking place and people are being fed, Luke intends for us to be reminded of the heavenly banquet of God. That great meal in the kingdom where God lavishes us with grace together with all of God's children. When Luke tells us about a meal, and he tells us about more meals than any other gospel writer, we should listen to the story as if it begins, as in other gospels, with the words, the kingdom of God is like. And at least according to our story for today, the kingdom of God is like the place where the need to seek one's own honor, be it through influence or accolade or wealth or any other human distinction, is put to rest by God's grace, which is an abundant resource that never runs dry. When God invites you to come and dine, God does not have any other agenda, any end game other than filling your hunger. And in fact, the only qualification you have to eat at God's table is the recognition that you are, in fact, hungry for the food that only God can offer you. And it is the willingness to humble yourself enough to accept God's hospitality extended to you, though you do not deserve it. Because as God says through the prophet Isaiah, you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you. The kingdom of God is where everyone hears our Lord speak these words over them and knows that they are true. That God gives us gifts with no strings attached, and that the seats of honor in the kingdom are not reserved just for a precious few, but for a precious all. Several years ago, NPR's StoryCorps ran a segment about a remarkable woman named Ruth Coker Burks, who was a young mother living in Arkansas in the early 1980s, about the time that the AIDS epidemic began sweeping through our country, bringing with it a whole host of fear and questions about honor and shame and who deserves care. One day, Burks happened to be visiting a friend in the hospital at the same time that one of the first AIDS victims in Arkansas was actively dying. And she heard him crying out from his room and noticed that the nurses were slow in responding to him. So she herself walked into his room and realized that he was crying out for his mother. Now, Burks had no medical training to offer the man, so she thought she could at least get his mother there. She approached the nurses' station and said, "That man wants his mama." To which one of the nurses replied, "Honey, his mama's not coming. He's been here 6 weeks. Nobody's coming." So Ruth walked back to his room, where she spent the next 13 hours with him until he drew his last breath. When he passed, she called his mother, who, perhaps terrified and ashamed herself, refused to bury him. So Ruth, without a second thought, took his body and had him cremated and buried in her family's own cemetery. And for many years afterwards, Ruth herself cared for as many as 1,000 AIDS patients, burying over 40 of them next to her own kin, giving those who were otherwise forsaken, otherwise rejected, otherwise overlooked their own places of honor, with no expectation of repayment. "When you have a banquet, invite those who cannot repay you," says Jesus. Because when you do that, you're loving the way that God loves each one of us. For each one of us has received the greatest gift we could have ever received at the hands of God in Jesus Christ, which is to know that we are precious in God's sight, and honored, and loved. And who among us can repay God? To God be the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
sisters, let us remain standing and affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. In response to God's grace to us, let us give generously. Lord our God, creator of all things and giver of all good gifts, we honor you for the very breath in our lungs, for the promise of this new day and this new season, and for the gift of your grace lavished upon us in Jesus Christ. In response to your goodness towards us, we lay our lives open before you and ask that you would stir in us, O God. Call us again to live the lives you would have us lead. Make us a blessing to each other and to our neighbors as we give our time, talent, and our resources into your service. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
this day with hope and with joy and be led back in peace. Go in the knowledge that in the goodness of God you were born. In the providence of God you are kept each day of your life. And in the love of God fully revealed in Jesus Christ, you are redeemed. Thanks be to God. Amen.